Thanks, Brandon. So good evening, everyone. Thank you so much for your patience and for being with us tonight. My name is TJ Woods, and I am the Associate Director of Tech Connect. I am so excited to welcome you to our first public Studio 40 showcase. That's right. So if you don't know, Studio 40 is a professional grade studio open to all New Yorkers. It's located right here at the Stavros Niarchos Foundation Library on the 6th floor. Like everything else at the New York Public Library, using the studio is absolutely free. Yeah. This moment was several years in the making. Studio 40 was an ambitious undertaking spearheaded by our Deputy Director of Branch Programs and Services, Dr. Brandy McNeil. Second row, give her some love. She wanted to create a community space where artists could make music, record podcasts, and produce videos to tell their stories here at the library. It's a magical space. I want to take a beat to thank the panelists for sharing their insight, the talented patrons who contributed to the showcase, and the Mayor's Office of Media and Entertainment for their kind support and celebration of New York Music Month. I also want to thank my wonderful team. I mean it. We could not offer these amazing events without their dedication and their brilliance. They solve all the problems. They do all the jobs. I'm especially grateful to the folks who run the studio. That's going to be Jenna Lee and Jose Toro. Is that love? If you know, you know. They have personally worked with every single performer that has come through Studio 40. It's a lot of time and a lot of love. To know them is to love them. They make magic happen every day. It's true. I see some, yeah, so you guys have worked with them, right? So lastly, this is the really important part. New York libraries face potential budget cuts to the tune of $36 million. I can't say boo because I'm on the stage. Please consider signing an advocacy letter as you leave. It's on the first floor. We really want to make sure that the city knows how important our libraries are and the good work that we're doing, not only in Studio 40, but in all of our Tech Connect programs and every single branch. It's so important to continue to offer services, not just here at SNFL, but in all of our locations. And we can't do that without your support. With that, I'm gonna turn things over to the incomparable Jenna Lee, who will be our MC this evening.
Thank you, TJ, and thank you all so much for coming out here today. We super appreciate all the support and for the friendly faces in the audience and the newcomers. We welcome you here to Newark Public Library Studio 40 Showcase. I just wanted to say a couple of things off the top to give you an idea of what you're in for today. We're here first with a panel for emerging artists, which we'll introduce in a minute, and we're also here with some folks from our Studio 40 community who will be sharing work, some of them for the very first time, some of them premiering works, some of them sharing works that are sort of in the process of being completed and made. Some of these folks are professional musicians and do this every day, and some of these folks, it is their first time presenting on such a large scale. So that means that you have a job as well, which is to make their art feel welcome into the world for the first time. This is a really cool chance to get in behind the scenes. As TJ said, we have a recording studio. It's a free public resource. This is available for folks who don't have the financial resources or the access to spaces that are gatekept by financial barriers and other things. And this is a space for anyone to come in and create. And they are bringing, they're bringing their artwork to the forefront to you. It's very tender. This is behind the scenes. And so if you have any comments or any negative commentary, today is not the day for it. We do workshops. We'll bring it up later. But if you have any negative comments, take it outside. This is not the space for that. I asked my folks. We ran some rehearsals this week, and I asked I asked everyone to raise their hand if they felt nervous. And I just want to share with you that almost everyone raised their hand. So if you know what it feels like to be an artist, give them just a little extra, an extra boost of support. This is not a chance for criticism. We had times of that. This is a chance for gathering courage to continue in the artistic process. These are people that, you know what the artistic process is like. It's wrestling with the demons. It's coming to terms with your identity. It's figuring out who you are, what you want to say. It's finding a voice after decades of not being quite sure about it, and, you know, really filling in the musical and artistic and visual and creative pieces that come together to make you unique. And these folks are doing it today. I think you'll be really touched and impressed by the breadth and diversity of their projects and the perspectives that they represent out of all of you and out of the city. It's totally wide-ranging. They come through these doors every single day to the New York Public Library, and they blow up my world. So I ask you to join me and open your heart and see what you can see from their eyes. Some of it's playful, funny, serious, intense, ridiculous, exciting. So see what you can find. So point of the story is be kind. These are new artists. You know what it's like. If you have critiques also, turn them towards your craft. And I want to see you up here next round. We'll do this again. We also have a very special panel with some folks that will be introduced in a minute. These panelists are going to share some advice for emerging artists. We sourced some questions from our artistic community here at Studio 40. So I'm going to introduce our panelists. Actually, I'm going to introduce our moderator, and she will introduce our panelists. So our moderator for this event is Keanna Faircloth. I met Keanna at an event recently, and come on up here. And she has really the confident hands of a radio host for WRTI, WBGO, NPR Music, then and now, NPR. Oh, sorry, NPR Music and then and now, NPR, and the host of the Artimacy podcast, writer for the New York Times, among many other wonderful credentials. So this is Keanna. Keanna's going to introduce our guest today. So thank you.
Thank you, Jenna. Hi, everybody. I'm just so excited to be here. What you all are doing here with Studio 40 is absolutely amazing and takes so much courage to come in and try something new, and even if you're not new to it, to want to continue to do what you're doing and hone your craft is so important, and I commend you all for it. So give yourselves a hand. This is great. All right, I've got some amazing people to bring up who are our panelists today, and I'm going to start right over here. Let's start with Gray Rizzy, come on up. Gray Rizzy, you can hear him right now on Hip Hop Nation and Shade 45 on SiriusXM. He's known for his engaging interview style. He holds no bars and, you know, pulls no punches at all. So you guys are probably familiar with his style of interviewing, which is absolutely amazing. And he's really sat down with so many industry heavyweights, including Puffy, De La Soul, DJ Khaled, RZA of the Wu-Tang Clan, and so many others. He's also been at the forefront of supporting breaking new artists such as Fetty Wap, Schoolboy Q, Tory Lanez, Young M.A., Nick Grant, and so many others. Lil Uzi Vert, ASAP Ferg, the list goes on and on. All right, Gray Rizzy, everybody. I'm going to bring up Ron Mills. Come on up here, Ron Mills. Now, Ron Mills is the Associate Director for Hip Hop at SiriusXM, and I just want to share something that was amazingly inspiring that he shared with me. He's so humble. He started over 23 years ago now at SiriusXM in the mailroom. And he worked his way up and has worked in every department. Right, Ron? Every department at SiriusXM.
A little bit.
Yeah.
Thank you guys for coming, sharing your time with us.
Absolutely. And I just want to share a few other things. He's helped organize major concerts with J. Cole and 2 Chainz, Plus the Dreamville concert at Red Rocks in Denver. He led a Super Bowl halftime interview featuring special guest Eminem and programmed SiriusXM's exclusive Nation's Next Virtual Festival with then-emergent acts like Lotto, Morey, Yella, and so many others. Ron Mills.
Yeah. Thank you.
And last but certainly not least, Mickey Factz. Come on up here. Mickey Factz is a Grammy Award-winning songwriter, well-respected lyricist, BET Cypher participant, XXL freshman, 2009 class alumni who strives to bridge the gap between hip-hop and academia. He's worked with everyone from Drake to Kanye to Lil Wayne, John Legend, Kid Cudi, and countless others. But I think his most notable and proudest accomplishment is his hip-hop academy, y'all. It's called Pendulum. Have y'all heard of that? We've got one of his disciples here, Q, raise your hand. And he can tell you all about Pendulum. And I'm excited to learn more about that. Mickey Factz, everybody.
It's Mickey.
Yeah.
All right, so you all were awesome enough to submit questions for our panelists to help guide you through the process, the creative process of making it as an artist, musician, creative, whatever it is that you do. So I'm going to be pulling from those questions, and I may, if we have time, have a few of my own, but we'll start with your questions that you have. All right, so the first one is coming from, I am Dwight Edmondson. Are you in the house? Dwight Edmondson?
I saw Dwight earlier,
yes. All right, Dwight, hey, how are you? So your question for our panelists here is, you say you're 59 years old this year. Wow, you look incredible. 59 years old, and this is not, and you've not lost the great ability to sing like Luther Vandross and Stevie Wonder. Okay. And many more. But what do you think of my chances now at my age, realistically? I would also love to develop and produce other artists as well.
Mickey, you want to start with this one? From the artist side?
I can start. Right. So from an artist's perspective, I think there's this negative connotation that if you are past a certain age, you are, you know, invaluable. And I think that narrative has to change, especially within the music industry. There are plenty of people that work in the music industry from a writing perspective, right? That are able to assist and collaborate with popular artists in order to craft and concoct either hit records or classic albums. I think that talent, right, unless you know you come across Alzheimer's, will never kind of leave a person's DNA. And I believe and wholeheartedly believe that networking is still the most important thing that anybody in any industry, in any field, will have in order to kind of make sure that their dreams come true. So from an artist's perspective, I would say that your contributions are not in vain, and you just need to continue to collaborate and network with the people in your surrounding circle.
Yeah, definitely. I think, immediately you have to believe in yourself, right? Because you're already in an uphill battle of where people are probably are doubting you because of your age or whatever reason. It kind of reminds me of when a promoter starts throwing parties. Some of the last people to show up to the parties are family and friends until the party starts popping. And then they want to show up and do what? Yo, can I get in for free? Right? A lot of times with music, at least on the radio side, and when it starts to reach its way towards me, age-wise, people are going to put, like, they're going to try to put you in a certain box, but you have to fight. You have to be able to fight through that. You have to be able to say that doesn't matter, especially in a day and age where, you know, you have the ability to upload from your home. You have the ability to go ahead and create your own network, your own following, and promote it yourself. But you have to figure out which way you want to get your music out to people. And you got to figure out what that path is and what's the most direct path for people to buy into you and then be able to hear your music. So you have to create a plan and figure out what that plan is, not only as an artist, but how are you going to promote yourself? How are you going to get out there and get that music heard? And then when you start to get the music heard by the people who may be in your neighborhood, may be in your town, city, your state, your regional locale, then how do you start to get that music played by people who can amplify it? Because now what you're talking about is marketing yourself. So if you are out here telling us, I don't know about Mickey or Ron, you already piqued my interest, and I'm pretty sure everybody in here, if you're talking about, I sound like Luther, and well, I want to hear some. I'm kind of curious. I'm not going to go too crazy. I'm going to wait until, did you create music? Are you one of the artists that created something?
Not yet?
All right, so I'm going to have to put you on the spot a little bit later on, but you've already marketed yourself to the point where I'm sure I'm not the only one in this room who wants to hear what you sound like. Now it's on you to show and prove.
Dwight, right? That's his name, Dwight. You know what, Dwight? If I was to hear your music, I wouldn't ask your age. My interest is your music. So you already putting something in a space where you're doubting what people are going to feel about your music. Let us judge that. Because if you guide, no, I know, I'm just talking about the question. I'm just saying, like, you put the age in there. If you get 100,000 people loving your record, nobody's asking about the age, man, you won. So, I'm interested in hearing some. So,
that's too
God bright. Bless, man. Always move forward, brother.
Awesome. This next question comes from Shelly Cool Singer. Wave your hand, Shelly. All right. So Shelly said, how can I get help with mastering and mixing without it costing an arm and a leg?
I'm trying to think of the saying. You can either have things, what is it, fast, quick, or cheap, right? Or is cheap, fast, or good, right? You have people out there that will walk, I can master and mix your stuff for $250. Then you got to have a product that sounds like a $250 mix. Or a $250 master. I think a word that Mickey used earlier, collaboration, and being able to network, and being able to tap into that network to find things that where maybe you'll be able to barter some type of services, or maybe there's something that you can work something out. But also understand what you're talking about when it comes to financials. What is the going rate? Like, how much should I be spending for this certain level of mixing and mastering? I'm pretty sure Mickey can talk to this a little bit more deeper than I can. But you want to know what you're paying for. You want to know the difference between that sliding scale of quality.
For me, I believe that if you're on a budget, YouTube is free. You can go on YouTube and just type in how to mix, how to master. And you'll see tons and tons and tons and tons of videos on how to mix. And from there, you can choose your level of engagement when it comes to mixing and mastering. Now, obviously, I would have to agree from the standpoint of you're gonna have to pay for something, right? You're gonna have to pay for equipment. You're gonna have to pay for the programs. And I would even suggest, reaching out to an engineer to shadow them, right? And be an intern and just kind of learn underneath someone from the perspective of an intern. And from there, you can then develop your own style when it comes to mixing and mastering. But the key to it is investing in yourself and investing with time first.
It's hard for me to jump in on this conversation because, my day-to-day, but me, I used to be a producer engineer as well. Locations like this, Studio 40 and what they're offering here is such a beautiful thing because of this thing that you're looking for, right? Mixing, mastering. Sometimes that's not your angle. You just want to focus on your artistry. But the key word with both these gentlemen said is relationships. Try to find a way to who's doing some stuff. Maybe you could find an engineer that'll probably, do somewhat of a good enough mix where it's, I'm not going to say probably releasable to the masses, but I think nowadays it's to put something online, it doesn't take a lot. But again, quality is everything, because that first listen could be the last one too. So, you know, it's how much you drive yourself and how much you want to invest in your product.
I know I'm the moderator, but I'm going to jump in on this one because I absolutely agree with you, Mickey. If there's something that you feel you can't, you know, it's not attainable right now financially, definitely learn how to do that thing. I've learned to do a number of things I didn't necessarily want to learn how to do because I didn't have the money to find somebody to do it for me. And as far as mixing and mastering is concerned, as a woman, there are very few female engineers who are mixing and mastering. So if you get into that, I mean, I think it would definitely break down some doors for other people. You never know who you will inspire by stepping up and learning something that you didn't even know that you could do, you know, just out of necessity. So consider that. All right. All right. So the next question is, this is from an anonymous source. The question is, what are the main sources of funding for independent artists to get produced? So sort of along the same lines. And moving forward, is there any way to make a steady stream of income at this? I'm guessing producing, that is.
From a production standpoint or from an artist standpoint?
I think the question is, they're looking for if you have any advice on main sources of funding for independent artists to get produced.
Okay.
That's
so
a deep question, Mickey.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's light. So
Mickey got all the facts.
Yeah, you know. I mean, so at my school, right? My school is called Pendulum Inc. And to your point, we're launching a production side called Pendulum Sounds, which we're teaching people mixing and mastering. But that's, I'm not here to sell that, right? In terms of finding sources of income, right, to finance and get your things started, it goes back to collaboration. Everybody here who is interested in the music industry, you should be working with other people, bartering services to get things started. When I started as an MC, I had about $10,000 saved. I left my job and I worked with an A&R, self-proclaimed A&R. I worked with a stylist. I picked a manager. I had a public. I had a personal assistant and I had a producer. And everybody had the same goals. Nobody wanted to be the head of the ship, right? Everybody kind of said, Mickey, you are the flagship artist. We will provide these services for you. And in turn, when a situation happens, you pay us back. So we had, now this is 2006, 2007, right? So everybody in here, they look like we all came from the same era, right? Around that time when the internet was here, it was free. Everything was free. There was no such thing as an algorithm. We were able to crack the code of the algorithm and reach a mass audience by providing them content that was never seen before. When you're an artist, you have to create content that people want to see and hear and be like. I always liken this to trying to create a brand that on Halloween people will see and want to be like you, right? So you have to figure out the same way, okay, you get over there, don't worry about it. If the same way we may invest in our clothing, the same way we invest in finer fine dining, the same way we invest in vacations. If you are an artist, you have to take that same amount of money and reinvest it into your content, your product, what you put into the world, make sure that it's high quality. And the money will come, right? And don't be afraid to go into Bandcamp, right, and put out music and allow people to set their own price. If you have 10 followers, those 10 followers, you just sell to them and you continue to grow that specific thing. I remember I used to work at Cutco. I used to work at Primerica. And the main thing that they told me in sales is you hire somebody, you get somebody to buy a knife or to buy this scammy insurance progress, and then you get them to tell that person. So if you have friends and family, you get them to tell them about your music. That's how you grow a fan base. And then you start selling them product that matters to them and to you.
That was well said.
Prime America. Whew, what a time to be alive. Jeez, I forgot about that right there. I think it's a tricky question. I think it's how do you go ahead and make money in anything? You know what I'm saying? Like, you got to build that fan base. You got to build that network. Especially right now, man. Something that I've been seeing, and I don't want to get off on a tangent because we've been talking about this no number one album or single in hip hop in 30 years as of late. But I think if you go out there and you keep on chasing a number, chasing a white rabbit, want to take the red or the blue pill, you're not really investing in the art. You're not telling your story. You're not giving a piece of yourself that's going to connect. You're not going to make any money in this. Because for the lightning to strike you right about now, there is such machines on the other side that you may not see. It may never happen. And it's going to frustrate you. So if you're going to do this, I think the number one investment you have to make in yourself is in yourself. And then you have to go ahead and make sure that people, you communicate that to the people who are going to spread the word, that word of mouth. Believe me, that's bigger than any ad you could take out on social media, because you have somebody who's actually investing their time to talk about you. So how do you make money in this while you're trying to be in it? Faith. Can't do it like just out the box. It doesn't happen. I want to be an artist and you start collecting money in some way. There's some people who do it. Sometimes they're not around to talk about it because they got jammed up in jail or something worse. And I don't think that's any of you. So for me, I know technically Mickey gave you some great ideas. I know Mills is going to say something, but for me, that's an enigma question. That's on you. How much faith do you have? Show us. We'll see you at the bank, because I'll be taking out my money, hopefully, to go ahead and support your project once I believe.
All right, it's very difficult to talk behind these two guys, but I'm going to tell you something. You never know who's in the audience. That's what I'm going to tell you. Paul Rosenberg could be sitting in the back. The CEO of Def Jam, the CEO of Universal could be sitting in the crowd. While you give it your all and your biggest day, your biggest performance, you never know who's in the crowd. I'm always looking for the next big thing. I've been, you know, honored to see the beginnings of a lot of these major artists. That could be you too. So if you know, the money will come. God, you know, like Grave Rizzy says, it's in God's hands, but you never know who's in the crowd, man. And that dollar bill could be sitting right in front of you while you're performing, or because of the question, it's too broad. It could be any type of product that you're selling. You never know who's watching. So, you know, Keep God first, like Grave Rizzy says, correct?
Yeah. We have about 5 minutes left here, just to let you guys
That's
know.
That's it? Damn. Yeah.
We want to get to the showcase, the reason we're all here. But
lightning round.
So I'm going to, this one is a longer question. I'm going to encourage you guys to meet us out in the lobby if you have additional questions. We are happy to answer them there. So I think this will be our concluding question here from Natalia. She says, is it a pipe dream to come onto the scene as an independent artist and remain such?
That depends on what your end goal is. I think you can be independent. I think you could be successful. But at some point, it may make sense for you to partner with someone where you're not independent, so to speak, where, you know, you don't have a major label behind you. But let's just say you've took over the States. And now it's time for you to go global. And I know I'm really making this easier, saying this easier than what it really is. But all conversations should be had. They're all exploratory. If you get to a certain point and you see that there's a ceiling that you're hitting and you're starting to hit your head, and now it's time for you to have that conversation with a major label, have the conversation. Because whatever may be holding you back from signing with the major, once you have that conversation, you get out the pros and the cons, and you hear exactly what this partnership may bring to you as well as your team, and whatever that goal may be, you might be blown away. You gotta have the conversation.
Is Natalia here? Are you here? Okay, so is your concern that you might feel like you'll sell out if you were to get to a point where you had the option of being with a major label?
Hi, I guess you just kind of see both, right? And I think a great example is like Frank Ocean busting out an album just so that when he was done with his contract, he could move on to what he really wanted to touch into. I guess, yeah, I really care about the message. And I would be a liar if I said I don't have a fear of too much tampering. Not collabing, but too much tampering. Yeah.
If I could jump in on that one, it's... I think it's the freedom of what you put out on your own time and when you say so. Like, again, you won't possibly have the machine of a major behind you that's going to put you in probably magazine covers and give you these big positions on these big festivals, but you could possibly do that on your own if you have that big of a following with what you're releasing. So, you know, it's a gift and a curse at times, you know. There's no rules to this thing, and it's what you make out of it. Like, your freedom to release when you want, to your fans when you say so. It's a beautiful thing, and as you can notice, a lot of these major signings have all gone back to being independent. You know, Talib Kweli, one of the biggest, like, he always sells TuneCore, and hey, it's my time, it's my music, it's my release, it's when I say so, Most Def. You know, these are all guys that have been signed to majors and come back to the realization that the freedom is very, very important to the music and to the character of your, or what you're releasing. So.
Hey. So I would
excuse
like.
Me, I just have a quick question for you, Mickey. I'm sorry.
What's up, bro?
Are you open to all conversations right now?
Yeah.
Would you use your leverage in those conversations?
Yes.
And if they offered you $100 million with stipulations where your wants and needs are met, not saying that you would necessarily sign the contract right away, but would you be open to that as well?
I mean, $100 million, yeah, I'm taking $100 million.
All right. That was just a little scientific experiment right there. Go ahead.
So, Natalia, I think I'm the only one on this panel who was an independent artist who got a record deal and then went independent. My challenge to you, my homework to you is this. Go home and buy a dry erase board. And on this dry erase board, you write your goals. What do you want, right? And when you write this, right, you write all of these things out. You put it in a circle, right? You put this thing in a circle. All of these things. You want a nice car. You want a home. You want a platinum record. You want a Grammy. You want a Billboard award. You want all of these things, right? Then you say to yourself, okay, what can I potentially get as an independent artist, right? So then you say, okay, I can probably get a car as an independent artist. You erase that from that, right? And you put it to the side, right? Because being in a major label, you're in this bubble, right? But when you're free, you're outside of the bubble and you do things your way, right? So Chance the Rapper, he was able to go get a Grammy without having a record deal. And the same thing with these gentlemen said here, there is no rules. You make the rules. You decide what your success is, because the message is way more important than anything anybody can sell you. And you have to stay true to what you believe in. That is the most important thing that anybody will tell you. Your message is what's important, because the moment you deviate from that, you begin to lose yourself within the art. And we don't want to see that for you, Natalia. So get a dry erase board, do that, and then also create a vision board and put things on this vision board that you would like to see for yourself. And I challenge everybody to do these things just in general and in life. Put your vision out there. It's a great therapy space, right? Where you can see what it is that you want to accomplish in life.
I think that's a great way to wrap things up. All right, Gray Rizzy, Ron Mills, Mickey Factz, please meet us outside, ask all the questions that we didn't get to. Thank you guys so much.
Thank you, everybody. We really appreciate y'all listening, man. Taking the time out.
We're going to have a quick stage change before we get our performers up here. But thank you so much to these panelists for sharing some personal experience and perspective. If you have questions for them, some of them will be sticking around and some of them won't be. But if you want to find Keanna or anyone in the cafe during our intermission, check out our sound gallery with folks' bios and QR codes to find out more about their artwork or follow them on Spotify, links to their social media pages. You are able to find that in the sound gallery outside on the wall. Also in your program, if you scan the QR code there, you'll be able to find out more about our artists and we can answer some more questions for you. I think we're transitioning right into our performances. So Rashmi is actually our first performer. Rashmi is from Queens and is actually one of our Studio 40 power users. He's been around for a long time and been with us from starting off our previous closed showcase. And I'm really excited to introduce her to perform Aguja. So as we had a little rearrange, you can move up if you feel like you want a better seat while we're getting settled. So those of you who are in the very back area, if you want to hang out back there, it's okay. We can't bite you, so you'll be good. But if you want, there are some seats that you could come fill in as well. Can we get a little mic too?
Hi everyone, my name is Rashmi, and that's spelled R-A-S-H-M-I. And I love Studio 40 because I've been able to go in there, and I'm a singer-songwriter and record, especially a lot of the songs that I wrote during COVID. And I'm going to be sharing one of those with you today. It is the COVID song. It's called Aguja, which is it's a loss of taste, and it was one of the symptoms of COVID, and this song is about choosing the alternative. When they said a sign would be a loss of taste, I remember thinking, is there any worse of fate? I don't think twice about death or dying, or leaving undone. But if pico de gallo, samosa or gelato would all just feel so numb. No, it's not for me a life without flavor. How call it living without a sense to savor? So if it's a choice that I have to make, I say take my life, but give me cake, yeah. Take my life, but give me cake. Aguja is a word from the Greek for loss of taste. Well, let's be honest about the choice I'd make. I'd rather have amnesia and forget all of your names, then lose the taste of coffee on a cold and rainy day. I don't think twice about death or dying, or leaving my life undone. But if chicken biryani, bacon or wasabi would all just feel so numb. No, it's not for me, a life without flavor. How call it living without a sense to savor? So if it's a choice that I have to make, I'll say, take my life, but give me cake, yeah. Take my life, but give me cake. They said Beethoven wrote the ninth when he was deaf, but I don't want the petty fours of an accusing pastry chef. I don't think twice about death or dying or leaving my life undone. But if dark chocolate, a mango or roasted garlic would all just feel so numb. No, it's not for me, a life without flavor. How call it living without a sense to savor? So if it's a choice that I have to make, I'll say, take my life, but give me cake, yeah. Take my life, but give me cake, yeah. Take my life, but give me cake.
Thank you, everyone. If you like what you heard, you can find out more about me at everythingrashmi.com. I have a new album coming out, which is going to be more of a dance album, so very different from this. So please stay tuned, everythingrashmi.com. Thank you so much. Thank you, Studio 40.
Thank you, Rashmi. Next up, we have Narissa Theobald. We actually have two sisters here, Narissa and Jerusha Theobald. Narissa is sharing a short video documentary.
She kind of took my words there. Hi, I'm Narissa. I'm a documentary filmmaker. I'm so glad you were able to come out and support. Tonight, I'm going to present my documentary short called The Perfect Shot. I just want to thank the NYPL staff, my sister, and have a wonderful evening. Thank you.
Approximately 30,000 pedestrians cross the Brooklyn Bridge every day. What attracts them to the centuries-old suspension bridge completed in 1883? Admiration for its steel wiring construction, a first of its time? A desire to traverse its 1.6-mile span by foot like John Wick? The Brooklyn Bridge is more than just a must-see historic landmark. The bridge is listed as one of the top 10 most iconic places to snap a shot in New York City. From sunrise to sunset, it's a hub for photogs, from the elite to the amateur, all searching for one thing, the perfect shot. Seeking to capture a treasured token memory of a moment in time.
We also have Narissa's sister, Jerusha Theobald, who is Narissa's collaborator, and she's also sharing a short film piece.
Okay, so hi, my name's Jerusha, and essentially, a lot of my art comes from looking at the little nuances that we miss. Everyone globally has been under so much stress, and now we use our eyes and we use our ears and we use our opinions to communicate, but we've all lost our sense of touch. So a lot of this is sort of venturing into finding those butterflies that you had when you were teenagers and you had no stake in the world and there was something that you wanted. And some of us were able to capture that. Some of us think about it years later during reunions. And it's just, when do we find that space to be connected by touch instead of opinions, instead of telling people telling you what to think and your brain trying to process that? So when do we as a society get back to getting in touch? So that's what I'd like to project. Thank you.
Hi,
Thank you, Jerusha. Next up, we have Tiffany Walker performing Promise to You with a background track. And Tiffany is a really wonderful R&B singer. I'm so excited for you to meet her.
Hi, everybody. My name is Tiffany Walker. I'm an R&B artist. I'm a singer, songwriter. I model. I'm an entertainer. I will be performing my original piece. It's called Promise to You. I wrote this song so that I can remind myself, as well as giving this to others to remind themselves of the promises that we make to each other, to ourselves and to each other, and just our journey in self-love. And I would love to connect with you all after the show, and more of my information is outside. But yeah, this is Promise to You.
I just want to take this time to write this letter to you.
I know I made you cry a thousand times. I know I probably told a thousand lies. After everything that we've been through, I wouldn't listen to me if I was you. I swear that you deserve the world, and you know that you're a special girl. All these other people don't deserve you. That's why I'm trying to say I'm sorry to you. I put you in positions you didn't wanna be in. Now all I wanna do is see you happy. But even if you can't accept my apology, just know it's always gonna be you and me. I promise to you, I really love you. Won't ever hurt you, baby girl, like I you.
Promise to you,
I promise to you,
I really love you.
Won't ever hurt you,
won't ever hurt you.
Just know that I'm true, and ain't nobody gonna hurt you again. We can slow it down and start as friends. I hate to see you like this, don't pretend. This world done messed you up, we can build again. I know you've been through more than this, and I know you're stronger than this, and just keep your head up, go ahead, sis. You got Jaden, you can't quit, so every little thing you do, just know that nobody else. All you got is yourself.
I promise to you,
I promise to you,
I really love you.
Won't ever hurt you,
won't ever hurt you.
Ooh,
baby girl, I love you.
I promise to you, to you. I really love you. Won't ever hurt you. Just know that I'm true. Thank you guys so much. Thank you for the studio. Thank you for everyone being here. Thank you so much.
Wow. Thanks for inspiring us, Tiffany. Yeah. Yeah, she's amazing. Next up, we have Tanya Ellis, who will be sharing an excerpt from an audiobook. Tanya is a podcaster and also an artist. Come on up here.
Hi, I'm Tanya Ellis. I'm a podcaster and a budding audio engineer. Tech Connect has been such a great resource for me, trying out different DAWs and learning how to rap chords properly.
Oops.
As an exercise for myself, I decided to produce an audiobook. So what you're going to hear are three snippets from a book that I recorded and that I'm currently editing. It's not finished. There's space in between each part, which is just enough time for you to feel a little bit awkward. This is The Glass Bottle Trick, written by Nalo Hopkinson and narrated by Nicole Birch.
The Glass Bottle Trick by Nalo Hopkinson. The air was full of storms, but they refused to break. In the wicker rocking chair on the front veranda, Beatrice flexed her bare feet against the wooden slat floor, rocking slowly back and forth. Another sweltering rainy season afternoon. The arid heat felt as though all the oxygen had been boiled out of the parched air to hang as looming rain clouds, waiting. Oh, but she liked this. Later then, Mistress Powell, giving herself the afternoon off, not even a by your leave, Gloria headed off to the maid's chamber at the back of the house to change into her street clothes. A few minutes later, she let herself out the garden gate.
That seems like a tough book for a young lady of such tender years.
Excuse me? Beatrice threw a defensive, cunning glare at the older man. He'd caught her off guard, though she'd seen his eyes following her ever since she entered the bookstore. You have something to say to me? She curled the Grey's Anatomy possessively into the crook of her arm, price sticker hidden against her body. 2 more months of saving before she could afford it. He looked shyly at her. When they had fed, would they come and save her? Or would they take revenge on her, the usurper, as well as on Samuel? Aguila, what a pretty basket.
Thank you, Tanya. Next up, we have Michelle Brown performing Each and Every Day. Michelle always impresses me because she made all of her work herself, produced in GarageBand, which is secretly my favorite DAW.
Well, just like she said, I made everything in GarageBand on my iPad. And also, you can find me as Shelly Cool Singer on Instagram and other social media platforms. And now I'm about to sing a song called Each and Every Day. Each and every day I live.
Thank you, Michelle, aka Cooley, Shelly Cool Singer. Next up, we have Isley Constantine sharing both a music video, actually debuting a music video. So this is the first showing in front of an audience, and then sharing a live song. Isley, you can come on up. We have affectionately referred to Isley as David Bowie on our staff due to a stunning cover of 5 Years that we met him with.
Thanks. That's fine. I love David Bowie. I drew this on paper. Thank you. I drew it on paper, and it's gonna be up there. Woo!
I would do to shake the memory of your embrace. 8 billion people land in this world, and there's only one I won't replace. But still we paint again. I'm sorry.
guess we have a tiny set change, but thank you. That I woke up with that song stuck in my head, and that, I felt like that was a good showcase day omen. As a disclaimer, I believe, if I remember correctly from the sound check, there are maybe a few profane words in this upcoming song. We're mostly 18 and up, but I know we have some children in the audience. Just want to disclaim that it's very necessary.
None that aren't in the Bible. Okay. Could I have more guitar? Okay. All right, more songs. Deep down, I don't know what the hell I'm living for. It's fake, so hard to take. Burn every bridge I built to watch you break. I'm lying flat. What do you think of that? I'm lying flat. Drive both of me. I don't get home. Turn off the news and chill. The best days are behind us, I can tell. So what the hell? Grab all the cash and spend it on ourselves. Wish there was a sign to make me wanna go on wasting time. So hard to find the patience to conform on this dead end track. I'm lying flat. What do you think of that? I'm lying flat. Drive over me. I don't get on. Cause it's a hard, hard way to go alone when you're living on your own or giving up control. Oh no. Yeah, it's a hard, hard way to go alone. Always paying what you owe or giving up the soul. The problems of the world's never enough. Too late to save the house, I'll let it burn. I can ask for help. I hate the song as much as I hate myself. So bide your time. Your parents stuck, get rich, and you're set for life. I'm lying flat. What do you think of that? I'm lying flat. Thank you.
Thank you, Isley. I'm hoping tomorrow I wake up with that one in my head.
It's not as catchy.
Next up, we have an artist, a multimedia artist named Dato Mio, also someone I met even before this library opened, so he's been with us for a long time. Dato's artwork is actually displayed, or a sample of it is displayed outside. Dato is a multimedia artist, and so if you check out his work in the cafe area, stop by and enjoy that piece. You want to come up? Yes, please come up. Dato is sharing two pieces, Psalm 1 and Discover Moments. I really loved working in the studio with Dato.
Hello, everyone. You're going to see two pieces. One is Psalm 1, which is part of a project where I'm interpreting the Psalms. And there's an audio and a visual component. And I'm still working on the visual. That's why you're just going to see the actual text on the screen. It was my first time actually working with audio. I've been a visual artist for over 20 years. And the second group of videos are a collection of really short videos. They're like under 30 seconds. And they're little moments around Manhattan. And so there are over 200 of these on my YouTube page. And as Jenna said, the images outside on the table are part of a project called Manufacturing a New Value System for Harlem, where I grew up. And I spent a few years photographing the entire neighborhood, block by block. And so that's just a small sample of that project. I want to thank Jenna and Jose and the whole Studio 40 and Tech Connect family for this really incredible opportunity to be able to explore and to create. And I always wanted to, a lot of my visual work video are silent because I always had a problem with sound. But I always wanted to get into it and learn. And this opportunity has really been incredible. And I want to thank all of you for being here.
I love seeing the world through Dato's eyes, so thank you for sharing. If you want to see more of Dato's work, some of the fabrics display is outside there, and you can find out more by talking to him. Right now, we're going to have a brief break. We're running a little behind schedule, so we'll keep it a short break, like 5-7 minutes, but a chance to use the restroom, speak to the panelists, and ask them your questions, say thanks for showing out here. Please do come back. We have another collection of really, really wonderful and excited artists who are going to share their work, and we would love for you to keep supporting them. So we still have some snacks outside. So we'll be back here in 5 to 7 minutes. Use the restroom, reorganize yourselves. Thanks for sticking around.
Hey everyone, we're gonna get started again with the second half of the show. So if you can come back in and grab your seat so we could get this ball rolling again.
I'll take a minute to introduce my colleague and partner in crime, Jose Toro. Jose. Jose is much beloved in the studio for many things, including his Pro Tools classes.
I make people suffer through Pro Tools for 2 hours.
Actually, so 6 hours total. You can get six hours plus deep dive workshops of Pro Tools. And you can also spend 3 hours in the studio with me and Jose for free. I just want to introduce my team. He is here. He's been behind the scenes, but he's,
I like being behind the scenes, notoriously. Yeah. Everybody knows that I'm rather shy and kind of short on words, but I'm floored by everything that I'm seeing here today. Literally, when we had the rehearsal, like I was literally getting like teary-eyed at like some of the things that I heard and saw, and it's really touching. It's just like, as Jenna said earlier, it's just such a wide breadth of different views and vantage points and voices and emotions, joyful, sadness, silly, but also just everything so tender and heartfelt. And it's just a joy to watch. And it's also like an honor to be a part of it and to help it, come to fruition. So congratulations to all of you, for everything that you've submitted and everything that you're going to continue doing in the future.
All right, with that said, we are going to, we're pulling in some last minute folks. Come on up, take a seat. We are going to start off the second half of our showcase with a performance from The Art Show. The Art Show is a multimedia artist, videographer, producer, makes beats, makes all kinds of music, actually. I feel like sometimes he lives at the library like me.
He does.
we see him all the time. He's doing art 24/7. He actually brought a clothing display of some of his artwork. It's out here. And you might see the art show floating around as he shares his work. His work is also for sale sometimes in Washington Square Park. But the art show submitted a introduction that will be read out to you by a digital voice.
Good afternoon. I am The Art Show. I am currently a freelance worker who designs clothes, hosts creative events, and produces beats. On my free time, I write poems, paint, draw, design clothes, and teach myself how to edit videos. In other words, I work on my free time. With that being said, thank you all for coming. I now introduce you to my creativity.
You can't stop my war, boy. 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 You can't stop my war, boy.
You can't stop my little boys. 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 You can't stop my little boys.
Wake up with that stuck in my head.
We also have a second film by the art show. Yes, that film was censored on Tuesday night during our rehearsal at request of me and Jose. So thank you, the art show, for doing a library edit of that film for us.
You know what's funny? It probably called more attention to the things that needed to be censored. It probably would have flown over your head if it was not beeped out. So.
All right, and this is a second introduction to a documentary piece that the art show is working on, and it's just a trailer for a longer piece that will be produced, I guess, in the coming months. All right, and for contrast, we have Sophia Campo Amor, who is a really beautiful singer-songwriter. And we met Sophia actually via her nonprofit, Hear Your Song. So Sophia is going to introduce both her work, which I really love, and also the nonprofit that she works for, Hear Your Song, that we've had studio sessions with some folks from there, and it's been really cool.
Yeah, so like Jenna's been saying, I work for a nonprofit that's called Hear Your Song. It's a national organization, but it's based here in New York City. And our mission, we're working with kids and teens who are dealing with serious illnesses and complex health needs and engaging them in collaborative songwriting. So that means they're writing all of their own lyrics about whatever they feel like writing about, from their health experiences to their favorite pasta to their favorite video games, really depends. And then they'll also be deciding what they want their songs to sound like, telling us what genre, what instruments, whatever kind of musical parameters get them engaged. And then our community of music volunteers will complete the tracks in the way that they describe them. So we've had some really wonderful group sessions that's been made possible by the library, since during the pandemic, a lot of our volunteers were having to work remotely and more isolated. It was really fun to come in together here and get to make the songs together in person. And so if you're a musician or someone who wants to contribute your skills by volunteering as a musician with some really wonderful kids, you can find me afterwards and we can chat about that. But additionally, you know, once I heard about the studio through my work, I was really excited because last year I was working on my debut album, and I got to record some really great backing vocals here at the library, and Jose heard me do the song so many times trying to get it right.
And so I still love it.
Oh, I'm glad. So yeah, the album came out in December. It's called If You Knew, I Couldn't Tell. It's kind of about falling in love with your friends. This is the closer, so this is the, we're moving on, we're making better choices. Didn't know how much I needed to leave till I was driving away. The screen door slammed behind me like a trap. With half of Pennsylvania passed, I finally found what I was trying to say. It's time to put myself back on the map. My favorite navigators told me it might take a while. They put me back together mile by mile. I still love you, but it's not enough to make me stay. Give me red horizons wide, I'll watch you fade to gray. You led me down so many roads. The nights were warm, the river would buzz. I wouldn't trade the sights we've seen for gold. But somewhere in the summer, I was losing track of who I was. I had to leave before the trail got cold. We sat inside your car as I was waiting for the bus, talking about anything but us. I still love you, but it's not enough to make me stay. Give me red horizons wide, I'll watch you fade to gray. Crooked over my bed, there's still a lot I've got to straighten out. I've never liked admitting when I found myself in over my head, but that's what growing up is all about. It's following a feeling and falling into kneeling and waiting for the heat. I still love you, but it's not enough to make me stay. Give me red horizons, wide, I'll watch you fade away. 'Cause I still Thank you. Thanks so much, Jose and Jenna, for having me. Thank you all.
I don't know who's cutting onions in here, but y'all gotta stop.
Oh, yeah, he's right. Next up, we have Studio 40 favorite, Mia Theodorakis. Mia is a harpist and also unconventional instrumentalist, and we have some twinning knee concerns. Yeah, that's why we're the team.
Between the two of you, you'll have like one good pair.
My favorite Mia story is Mia got held up by security trying to bring an entire gamelan into the library in a shopping cart. So she kept it small today and just brought the lyre, but you'll hear some of the background sounds that Mia's collected.
Hi. So the great thing about this studio and everybody there is it gives me the space to dream in, because I play with a lot of people, because when they fire the other person and they need someone to play the part, that's me. And this right here is a bunch of gamelan bells from about 1900. And then it has a tempura, an ancient lyre, and my parents are anthropologists, so there's some shaman rattles in there. And I just created this backdrop that I can use for, like, I didn't know what I was going to do with it. But that's what this is, and I've been using it to improvise, and so. Playing Night of a Thousand Stevies at Irving Plaza, and Johnny Dinell, who's a DJ, mixed up some Stevie Nicks for me. And before I, with my limp, I limped on stage with some Buto dancers, and I used these tracks I did at Studio 40. So, and that I've also done a lot of outsider music on 17th century and 18th century instruments, but we can go to the other track. The video.
Thank you. Thank you, Mia. Next up, we have ukulele player Izzy Tan.
Hi, Izzy.
Hi.
Yes. Izzy definitely brought a really bright air to our orientation, which is a couple. You came last month to the studio orientation.
Yes. And you'll relatively find relatively new to the community.
The craziness. But Izzy really stopped us all in our tracks for a minute, and you'll hear that actually in the middle of this song, and I definitely need it today.
Me too. Hi everyone, my name's Izzy. Hello. I'm hoping I remember everything that I want to say. I'm a folk pop singer-songwriter. I'm originally from Virginia, but I think I can technically call myself a New Yorker after living here for 12 years and also a pandemic, so I stayed for it. My music is really centered around relationships, so romantic friendships to ourselves. I've even written a song, not the one that you'll hear tonight, but about my friend's elderly deaf and blind cat. And I'm excited to record a bunch of new singles with the help of Studio40. I just found it last month, which I'm really excited and been really excited to hear everyone's art tonight. And the song I'm going to be singing for you tonight is called Time Is On Our Side, which is really about being present. I think in New York, we're constantly running from thing to thing. We're thinking about all of our responsibilities, all of our to-dos. We're chasing our dreams. Maybe we're upset about something we did in the past. And we really forget about the only moment that we have, which is the one that we have right now together. And so just a reminder that happiness can be found in this moment together. And there is going to be a moment of crowd participation. I'll let you know when that happens. You'll know it. I'll pause, and then I'll look at you all, and then I'll be like, okay, we're starting. So here it is. It's called Time Is On Our Side. So we're all going to take a deep breath in and out together, breathing in and out.
'Cause time is on our side if we just stop, if we just stop, pause and take your time, look at your life, look at your life.
Thank you all so much. Thank you, thank you.
Thank you, Izzy. Next up, we have a duo performance. We have Johansel Estrella and Natalia Gonzalez. Johansel is playing electric guitar, and Natalia is playing mandolin. And actually, I think this duo I met also last month in our orientation, and they shared a piece together, and we're in the studio even, I think, Monday this week.
It was Monday.
Recording yeah. stuff.
Super fun session. Figuring out, like, what, you know, you guys want to stand, sit, like, just trying to figure out the whole process.
The important stuff in yes. the studio. If you're sitting or standing, they're sitting.
Yeah, we did. We started on the floor, then I think the piano bench, and then we stood for the final take. Hi, everybody.
Check 1, 2. Yeah.
Thank you, Natalia and Johanso.
Thanks, Jenna.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you, Jose.
Next up, we have an act by Annie Hayworth. Annie is one of, actually, a trio, Basil the Rat, who you'll see dancing us through the end of our showcase. But Annie is going to come up with an electric guitar solo set. So this is Annie Hayworth.
Thank you. Hi, I'm Annie Hayworth. Yes, I'll be playing with Basil the Rat later. Today, I actually released a new EP under Annie Hayworth. It's called Hurt, Heal, Hurt. You can find me on basically any music platform under my name. And what else? So the song I'm going to play today is called Roadkill. I actually have an animation for it on YouTube and multiple other music videos if you want to check those out. And any artists, I'd love to work with you on music videos. This song, Roadkill, is about three crushes that me and my friends Opal and Helen had on three different people who did not like us back. So the theme of this song, basically it's just about, you know, your crush doesn't like you back, so you go burn his house down. Woo!
Why not?
Jacob Jeremy goes to therapy in the same office as me. His hair is curly, his body's kinda girly. He smokes too much and he's 6'3". Everything he does keeps me guessing. I hope I see him after my next session. Can't stand to see his face on my phone. I guess I'm gonna spend another night alone. There's a fire in the pit behind my house. Do you think he'd come and help me put it out? I'm asleep at the wheel trying to tell him how I feel. I'm awake in the dark watching from my car. I am trying to hide till the lights go up inside. I don't think I can carry this load. I've been thinking about you instead of the road. Steven Spaulding has premature balding, but he and his sister are still pretty hot. I asked him come over, he told me it's over. I guess I was thinking I would give it a shot. I just want a guy who really likes me, a guy who will hold me and feed me and fight me. I want to feel his flannel on my skin. I don't know how I let this obsession begin. There's a fire in the pit behind my house. Do you think he'd come and help me put it out? Mallory Mixon looked like a vixen, sitting there drinking her soda pop. She kissed my face and she tasted like grapes. There is nothing in this world that feeling couldn't top. Waiting for a text feels like fire. That little red number's never getting higher. She's blonde and she's tall, but she's so unfair. I just want to know the color of her underwear. There's a fire in the pit behind my house. Do you think she'd come and help me put it out? I'm asleep at the wheel trying to tell her how I feel. I'm awake in the dark watching from my car. I am trying to hide till the lights go off inside. I don't think I can carry this load. I wish I'd said yes when you asked about my eyeshadow. I wish I didn't have to carry money everywhere I go. I want a lot of things and I want them so hard. But mostly I just want to be in the backseat of your car. I'm asleep at the wheel trying to tell him how I feel. I'm awake in the dark watching from my car. I am trying to hide till the lights go up inside. I don't think I can carry this load. No, I don't think I can carry this load. I've been thinking about you instead of the road. Thank you.
Thank you, Annie Hayworth.
You can find me on anything as Annie Hayworth, or scan my QR code out there for all my links.
My surgeon said I was allowed to mosh, so next time. And also, yes, after home, we talk about burning it down. We have up next Breezy Smoke, who will be playing electric guitar and performing the song called Saturn Hue.
Hi, everyone. I'm Breezy.
I stand to watch the ships go by. Not a thing in the world can stop me. I listen to the bubbling tides, rippling blue. Never felt so hesitant to you.
We have Dylan Mohammed sharing a piece that he's been working on in Ableton. I feel like you came to the studio for the first time to produce stuff about a year ago, and this is the work that you've been doing, but you've got a lot more to come.
Couple things about Dylan. I'm sorry, if I could just speak about Dylan real quick, because he's come to every single one of my classes. Logic 101, 201, 301, Pro Tools 101, 201, 301. And then I developed a class on Ableton, and I was like, I wonder if people are going to come to the Ableton class. He came to the Ableton class, and the piece that he's going to do right now is made on Ableton. So
yes.
Shouts to Dylan, man.
Hello, everyone. So I'm Dylan. I have been just exploring what I want to work with as far as like a DAW, and it's Ableton. So this is an example of just some of the artists that influenced me, like Janet, Aaliyah, Sister Nancy, Shaka Demis. So it's a blend of R&B, pop music, some houses in there, and even reggae. So I hope you enjoy it. Thank you.
We will hear the full piece. Yeah. It's 5 minutes. We'll hear it closing the showcase. So we're going to listen to an excerpt. So
about a minute.
About a minute, and then we'll hear the rest of it at the very end of the showcase when we're all dancing our way out the door.
Get the point? Good. Let's dance.
be continued. Next up, we have Lancelot Chaubert, who is sharing a pre-recorded piece. Lance has been a really supportive member of the Studio 40 community and a lot of experience with new artists, so we appreciate you coming out today.
Yeah, I mean, for Robert and Jose and Jenna, can we give it up for them again? Because this is kind of, especially with, so I'm grateful you let me share tonight. And can I be honest, what this is about? My dad died this year of cancer and COVID, and it was the week he was supposed to meet my firstborn son. And it was a year after my brother and sister-in-law lost my brother's mother-in-law to cancer as well. And so I've written songs before, but I really wanted something that hit my brother's style of music that he would actually listen to, and then also told the story of both his parents. So that's kind of what this is. If you like it, maybe add the song to your playlist or whatever. But I'm just grateful to be here with you guys. This is really, really cool stuff from everyone. So.
Together in our little town, we were sweethearts from about age 16. But your daddy was rich and mine was real poor. They said I had nothing I could offer a wife to give you any kind of decent life. But sometimes I think they were right. When I think of the ways that I down, all the dreams that were never to be. It's amazing after all we've been through, you still believe in me. Well, you went to college and I went to work, and money was tied all the time. We fought over pennies, things. Sometimes I got ugly and I was a pain. You worked like a dog and the kids were insane, but somehow you never complained. When I think of the ways that I've let you down, all the times we could never agree, it's amazing after all we've been. Since the day we first wed, I'd have never made it without you. It's the truest thing I ever said. Well, you came down with cancer, I went back to work to pay for one treatment a week. But we ran out of money, they ran. Our family at the side of the grave. God love you for being so good and so brave. With the preacher, I'll stand up and say, when I think of the ways that I've let you down, all the things that you never would see, I know, my darling, wherever you still believe in me. Oh, you still believe in me.
Thank you, Lance. Thank you for sharing that honest moment with us. Next up, we have Glenn Rubin, who I've also met, just before the pandemic, yes. I met Glenn just before the pandemic, before this library was built, in a
it
podcasting
was February 24th, 2020. It was a class at Sybil about podcasting. I had no idea what a podcast was. But when I found out, wow, it's just like listening to the radio and the talk shows, and I can do this. So I decided to make my own podcast. At the time, I was going to talk to and interview people on Times Square. I was homeless at the time. I still am, actually. Well, unfortunately, nobody wanted to talk. And everybody just wanted to be safe and away from people. Okay, fast forward. I'm still homeless. The title of my podcast is Urban Camping, which I think is better than saying that I'm sleeping on the street. If you meet me outside or on the street, you wouldn't think that I'm homeless. You would think I'm just a normal person carrying a lot of stuff, a little crazy guy wearing a colorful scarf on a summer, really warm day. But that's who I am right now. I'm also the oldest nursing student up until the pandemic. I went back to college after I became homeless in 2006, after I got a disability award. It wasn't expected that I would go back to school. I was living in Atlantic City. The odds are I would go play gamble, but I didn't do that. Went back to college, and I mastered every subject I took. So like anatomy and physiology, I became the tutor for the college. Calculus, I reviewed the teacher's work. He paid me. That didn't make a lot of my classmates happy. I would spoil every curve. I would get 100, then the next highest grade would be a 40. So I didn't make too many friends. And I also got a lot of hate. I'm openly gay, Jewish, and just very smart. At the time, I was also no family and no friends, so I was easily victimized. And I could be, bullied, you might say. So eventually, I got kicked out of South New Jersey. Got away from the hate group, came to New York, figured it'd be better, be in a gay-friendly city. But they followed me, and every time they did, I just got stronger and better. They got me out of school. They helped me to lose my job. But because of that, I had a place to stay. I had the federal funding assistance during the pandemic allowed me to get a hotel room on my own, through my own money. And it was luxury living, I'll tell you that. So I'm a problem solver. I made about 6 patents related to COVID. But who would believe a homeless person can solve a problem like COVID? Nobody did, but if you go on my Twitter account, you can see a concept of a shield that would replace the face mask that most of you wear. I think that Colin Powell would be alive today had I patented that device. Now, being homeless, I keep on thinking about how can I solve this problem? Well, I have, because I look at it, and I have to say to the mayor, I'll give you a B for trying, but you get a big F for what you've done. The definition of insanity is repeating the same behavior and expecting a different outcome. And that's exactly what he's done. He has repeated the behavior of the previous administration plus the behaviors of other states like California, expecting the homeless problem to decrease. It's only getting worse. And if there's anybody from the mayor's office, contact me. I'd like to sell my plan. I consider it intellectual property. I've spoken with a lawyer, a civil lawyer, thanks to volunteering during AIDS Walk about 3 weeks ago. They connected me with somebody, and that person agrees that my plan is workable and doable and would save the city lots of money. the city spends at least $10 million a day for the homeless and homeless-related services. And what do we get out of it? Crazy people beating up on innocent victims. That's not acceptable. These people have to be made aware that they have to be responsible. They have to pay their fair share. If not, get out of the city. It's not your city. The city belongs to the people that work and are willing to pay their fair share. Congregate settings, in particular, they're a breeding ground for hate. So just want to say thanks to TechConnect for teaching me a lot more than just podcasting. And a shout out to the Friday afternoon crafting class. So thank you for listening to me babble, and God bless America. Aren't you glad you're not that person shaking, shivering on the ground? Aren't you glad you're not that person whose pants are falling down and wearing no shoes? Aren't you glad you're not that person smoking leftover cigarette butts from the ground? Aren't you glad you're not that person going through the trash for leftovers? Aren't you glad you're not that person wearing the same clothes for weeks at a time? Aren't you glad you're not that person you can smell more than 20 feet away? Aren't you glad you're not that person carrying their life's possessions on them? Aren't you glad you're not that person? Hello, and welcome to Better Days Ahead. My name is Glenn Rubin, and this is a very special podcast. It is my first. And today I will be talking about homelessness here in New York City, something that I have a lot of experience in, as I have been homeless here in New York City for more than 5 years. I also have lived in the shelter system of New York for more than a year, and this I will never do again. I would rather die on the streets. I am street homeless now, meaning I live or sleep on the street or more often in the subways. Funny thing is, if you see me in person, you do not think that I'm homeless. And if I tell you that, you don't believe me. That's because I have a different mindset.
Thank you, Glenn, for sharing your perspective. We have one more act for you, and the library actually closes at 9 p.m. And so we have a couple minutes to dance to this very dancey crew and get another culture shock of different experience next to different experience. And then we're going to ask you to quickly gather your belongings and dance your way out to Fifth Avenue. Actually, sorry, you have to exit on 40th Street, as everyone Thank knows. So this last act is Basil the Rat. It is a trio led by Finn and featuring Annie, or Noel, and Jace as well. Annie's on keyboard, Noel is on keyboard, and Finn is on electric guitar, and Jace, Annie, and Finn are all on vocals. This is our last act of the night. I encourage you to find the fun and joy in it, dance along. I just want to say, while they're setting up, One of the things that I really loved from one of our patrons, I'm not sure where he is today, but Dato shared with me that he thought that art was alchemy. It's taking the experience that you had and turning it into something else that gets you through the next thing. And I really appreciate that perspective. So let's have some fun.
Let's. All right. Yes. Hi, I'm Finn.
I'm Annie. Jenna revealed my secret identity.
Sorry.
It's okay.
And I'm Jace.
And we are Basil the Rat. We are a brand new queer indie band from here in New York. We just started in April, actually 2 days before our first show. it was sort of an open mic, but anyway.
We're here now.
Yes, yeah. We're here now. We've had a bunch of shows already, even though we've only been around for a little bit. And the song we are going to play is called, oh, yes. You should sign up to our mailing list. The QR code is on our poster outside. The song we're going to play is called Advance Notice. I wrote it and I produced the backing track. And actually, I am going to release it with my independent work. My artist name is Everyday Gray. Three separate words. Gray has an E in it. I also have a poster in the sound gallery with my own website. And it's going to be the lead single on my upcoming album set to be released around November. It's going to be called something like Cabaret, Nightmare at a Dream School. And it is a, let's see if I can remember, campy rock opera of all different genres, reimagining a experience I had getting ostracized from a friend group at college as a supernatural werewolf story. I really hope you enjoy. Yay. You just be honest. You know me now, I'm honest. I won't be mad. I had a feeling you'd be different. You wouldn't care, I'm different. A special kind of I mean a different kind of special. You're a different kind of special. Said I wanna do whatever will make you happy. And I need you to tell me just what that is. Feel free to dance. All hang on to my hope, cause you are keeping me close. All I want, all I want, all I want, all I want is you. I was flattered you trusted me. I was flattered you held on to me.
And it mattered so much to me. Cause you matter so much to me.
Doesn't matter.
What's done is done.
Doesn't matter.
Gone is gone.
I'm a sadder
automaton.
I'm sadder.
How comical.
I disagree that this is the way that it had to be. I disagree that you gave me a chance. Said I want to do whatever will make you happy. Drummer, contact us if you need, if you play drums.
Artist, we'll make sure you get out.
Are you in the
ER?
Did you take it
too far?
Did your life get
too hard?
Are you in the
ER?
Are you in the
ER?
Did you take it
too far?
Did your life get
too hard?
Join our mailing list.
Woo!
Said I wanna do whatever will make you happy. But I disagree that this is whatever is. I will leave you alone if you don't pick up the phone. All I want, all I want, all I want, all I want is a dance notice. Said I wanna do whatever will make you happy. But I disagree that this is whatever is.
You're very welcome.
I will leave you alone if you don't pick up the phone. All I want, all I want, all I want, all I want is here. Thank you so much, Studio40, and everyone for coming.
Thank you so much for coming. Please clear the space as fast as you can safely. And we'll see you for the next round.